Good morning, everyone, and welcome to WOLFcon 21. We're very happy that you're here with us today. This is the World Open Library Foundation Conference. It's hosted by the Open Library Foundation. This is our third annual WOLFcon, and it continues to grow and develop as our community builds and evolves. This is our first virtual conference, and we've been slowly incorporating virtual aspects into the conference over the past two iterations. And so, like many things with this pandemic, it spurred us to do a virtual conference, and we're really excited that everyone's here with us today. I'm Beth German, the Senior Program Officer with OLF, and myself and Stephanie Buck, our Assistant Secretary, will be emceeing the conference, just being the face that you'll see at the beginning of each session. And that will be here if you have any questions. We also have on hand our conference logistic and technology expert, Kate Waldron, who would also be able to help out. So please don't hesitate to reach out. We want this experience to be pleasant for everyone. And so let us know if there's anything we can do to make that experience better. I'm just going to go over a few things to the logistics before passing the session over to Tom Cramer, the president of the OLF Board of Directors, who will talk more about the foundation, its vision, and the goals for the future. We then have our keynote, Kaitlin Theaney, the executive director in Invest in Open Infrastructure, a nonprofit dedicated to improving funding and resourcing for open technologies and systems that research relies on. So that's what the morning session will look like. And we're, again, happy that you're all there. That's rather predictable. Sorry about that. We'll move on now. Thank you. So to start, the foundation is a community of communities. The open source products are built, developed, and maintained by small to large groups of dedicated individuals. And the foundation seeks to build, foster, and support collaborations and relationships, as well as develop resources for these communities. We currently have five communities that are part of OLF. The Advanced Research Consortium, a consortium of scholars committed to advancing research in the humanities through online communities built around peer review, aggregation, and searching digital data. Folio is a collaboration of libraries, developers, and vendors building an open source library service platform, supporting traditional resource management and can be extended into other institutional areas as well. GoKB is a community-managed open data platform that provides information about electronic resources. ReShare, a community-owned modular resource sharing platform designed to offer seamless access to shared library collections and facilitate content efficient and to facilitate efficient, intuitive workflows for library staffs. And VUFine, a powerful and flexible discovery layer. And so each of these groups are different, and they are more than just their products or technology stacks. They really are groups of individuals coming together for a common goal, trying to build something new. And that these organic communities are bringing that perspective to OLF, and that is what we want WOLFcon to be about as well. This year's WOLFcon has been designed and the content generated from the OLF Roundtable. The Roundtable is a group of community leaders from the different project communities, and through these discussions with the leaders and between the different projects, in addition to a smaller working group, that content really represents a conversation and the network between different communities. So I would like to thank our planning group. We have the OLF volunteers and executive group that have been diligently working through the logistics. I may want to highlight Kate Waldron, Stephanie Buck, and Rachel Fadlin for all their work in the planning phases. Also, the roundtable working group, this smaller group of individuals have been helping steer the direction of the conference, but they also have been serving liaisons back to the communities. There's over 40 different presenters from all over the globe, and these liaisons have been helping wrangling, developing the abstracts, developing the sessions, and we're really thankful for all the work that they have done. I'm
We'd also like to give a land acknowledgement at this time. We have attendees and speakers from many places where Indigenous people were depossessed and removed. I've decided to give a specific land acknowledgement where I'm at and the location of our last in-person WOLFCon. We acknowledge that Texas A&M University in College Station, Texas is situated on the land of multiple Native nations, past and present. These original homelands are the territory of Indigenous peoples who were largely depossessed and removed. We specifically acknowledge the traditional stewardship of this land by the Tawakani, Waco, Sana, Wichita, and Coahuiltecan peoples. We pledge to support and advocate for the histories, cultures, language, and territorial rights of historic Indigenous people of Texas and the Indigenous people that live here now. This statement affirms continuous Indigenous presence and rights, acknowledges the ongoing effects of settler colonization, and supports Indigenous struggles for political, legal, and cultural sovereignty. I'd like to also remind and inform everyone of our code of conduct. Participation in WOLFCon should be a harassment-free experience for everyone. If there are instances of abuse, harassing, or otherwise unacceptable behavior, please contact us at conduct-report@openlibraryfoundation.org. Now, as just a few more further logistics, we got a great, great program this week. We have mostly project sessions and topic sessions. And so project sessions are going to be general overviews and updates from the different project communities. And then topic sessions will either be a number of different things. They could be collaborations across projects or software, topics of interest in terms of building and sustaining open source communities, or growing areas of interest where open source projects are developing or could be an answer. So again, this has been a conversation that we've been working throughout the OLF community, and we're really excited for everything that will be presented this week. So just a final list of checklist of things that I need to make sure that I say. So the Zoom links are in the schedule. I think that if you're here right now, you hopefully found them, and that you click on the open Zoom with the yellow button on each of the event pages that then takes you to a registration so that you can get into the Zoom. There will also be breaks throughout the day. We try to make sure that there is breaks between each session, and then there's a longer intermission about halfway through so that all our needs can be taken care of. Live transcriptions are enabled in each session, and so let us know if there's any issues. At the bottom of the Zoom screen, there is a button that says live transcriptions, and you click on show transcriptions to be able to get to that. Most of the sessions will be available for review after the recordings will be made available. There's a few instances where the presenter might ask us not to make that available, and that would be the only reason we wouldn't be sharing it out, but we'll try to make slides available if that is the case. We'll be sending out a survey after the conference. We would really appreciate your feedback for any future OLF programming, as well as for our WOLFCon 2022 conference, that which will be in Hamburg, Germany in September of 22. And so please let us know how things go and what you're interested in learning more about. There will also be an option to win a free WOLFCon t-shirt. And then lastly, our hashtag for the conference is WOLFCon21. And so I think that's my list of things to share with you all. There is the Q&A function within Zoom. So if you have any questions, please feel free to send us any messages. And then also there's the chat feature for messaging the panelists. So with that, I think I will turn this over to Tom.
Thanks so much, Beth. Well, happy Tuesday to everyone. Good morning for those of you who are also on the West Coast of the United States. And I am here today to give a little bit of an introduction for those of you who may not be familiar with it to the Open Library Foundation. And we do have a little bit more time than was originally budgeted. Our keynote presenter, Kaitlin Theaney, has just texted that she is facing a personal emergency and will plan to be on, but she may be on somewhat later than we thought. So I'm going to suggest in the fullness to make the most of the time that we have. We'll see if Kaitlin makes it before we wrap up. But Beth did highlight the Q&A feature at the bottom of the screen. And if anyone has got questions, suggestions, ideas, or inspiration, please don't hesitate to add it into the Q&A as we go. And maybe we'll have a little bit of time when I'm done, but before Kaitlin arrives. So in starting, well, I guess I should introduce myself first. Thank you for Beth for the kind introduction. So my name is Tom Cramer, and I am the Associate University Librarian for Digital Library Systems and Services at Stanford University. And I'm also president of the Board of Directors for the Open Library Foundation since January 1st of this year. And to start with, I wanted to discuss and reflect a little bit about the mission of libraries, especially the mission of libraries in the information age. So the mission of libraries is, I think, timeless. We serve by providing access to information for the citizens of scholars for today and for tomorrow. That doesn't matter whether you are a national library, a research library, an academic library, a public library, a private library, a corporate library, or a special library. We each have our designated communities and collections and patrons that we serve, but we all have a common mission. IFLA, the International Federation of Library Associations and Institutions, estimates that there are more than 2.6 million libraries across the world. And they've gathered data from not all of the countries of the world, less than 208, but something more than 180. So there are probably even more libraries than they're estimating. Together, we form a vast network that provides on-ramps to the commonwealth of human knowledge. And I've, over the last 15 or 20 years, has often been a question to me is, what's the point of a library in the age of the internet? Why do you need a library when there's Google? And I would say actually, or not just Google, but the internet and search. And I would say that right now, actually, the importance of libraries is all the greater in the information age. You may have heard some key phrases. So things like data is the new oil. This was coined by The Economist in 2017 when they noted that the market capitalization of information companies like Amazon and Apple and Google had actually exceeded the market capitalization of traditional manufacturing firms, which, or quote unquote oil, which had dominated the 20th century. You might also have heard that the phrase from Stuart Brand, both famous and infamous wording, that information wants to be free. What's often not posed along with that is that the other part of the sentence, or the other part of the discussion, is information also wants to be very expensive. It's so valuable that information really presents something that people will pay for. And that tension between wanting to be free and that tension between wanting to be for fee will not go away. This is foreseen decades before, a decade before the internet, and I think is more true now than ever before. Now, what will the future of libraries be? Hold on one second, sorry, some technical difficulties here. What will the future of libraries be moving into the next decades and the next century? How will society navigate between free and fee for information, especially when there's such an abundance of information and the discovery, the access, the curation of information becomes more important than ever? My crystal ball is murky, but what I do know is that libraries are already poised, well-versed, and actively playing this role in navigating the tension between fee and for free. I also know that we are still, if not the infancy of the internet, it's awkward childhood. I'd say it's not quite an adolescent, It is still growing and exploring. It is still developing itself at an incredible pace as society develops it and it develops society in return. It's arguably the greatest creation of humankind, and it's still less than an adolescent. What we do today will certainly shape the internet as much as the internet shapes us and the way we and our children access information going into the future. You may also have heard another quote from Marshall McLuhan, the communications theorist from 1964, who wrote that the medium is the message. This is about the fact that while content is in fact carried by new media and by new channels, such as the internet, or in Marshall McLuhan's case, television and film, the medium itself carries as much information and makes as big an impact as the individual content. As film developed, for example, the conceptual structure and the logical flow of how people conceived of time, segmentation, and communication developed with the medium itself. One thing that I do know about information and where my crystal ball is not murky is that information is inseparable from the systems that deliver it. Digital information is nothing more than ones and zeros encoded on magnetic or optical storage media. And unless you have the full stack of systems that are used to encode it, store it, transmit it, and display it, that information actually has no meaning. Software is one of the layers, along with hardware and the networking, the devices that we actually use to read the information itself, is an essential element in that layer, and software is incredibly powerful. Other than content itself, where an idea by one person can spark a revolution or reach millions or billions of people worldwide, software is incredibly powerful and the highest leverage element in this entire stack. Code that's written from a single developer or a development team or a single source can be used by millions or billions of people. It generates vast value. It provides access to the information. It enriches and parses and delivers this information. And it can also bring vast power with it. One more quote, and the last one for my presentation, is you may have also heard that technology is neither good nor bad, nor is it neutral. This is one of Kranzberg's six laws. Kranzberg was a professor at Case Western Reserve University. And he was writing about six axioms of technology as it develops. It is certain that those who, just as information cannot be delivered by the systems that encode it and deliver it, it's also true that the systems and the information it carries is reflected by the people who create, maintain, and to deliver it. This brings me to open source software. As we all know, software, there's multiple different flavors of software, and it is protected by intellectual property rights. And many of the constraints, either wittingly or unwittingly, that were introduced to present other forms of content and intellectual output. Open source software is distinctive in that it is structured, it's inherently structured, it is designed to be used, modified, and reused by others. It implies a community and if in terms of reuse, and it is often produced by a community working in collaboration with each other. Open is free rather than for fee, and open is powerful. At the Open Library Foundation, we believe in the power of open. We believe that open creates opportunities for innovation and the most innovation, as well as collaboration, people working together in common concert for a common mission. We believe that open promotes interoperability, where systems and data actually work with other systems and data that are created and used elsewhere, rather than locked into a walled garden. We believe that open is a key element of sustainability. It is only through open source where you actually have control ultimate control and access to the software. You can be sure that the systems and the software that are developing and delivering the information are carrying through, and that they won't be taken away or changed by an individual provider's business strategy or change in wind. Finally, we believe that open brings with it the power of self-determination. Rather than being defined by a single, rather than being defined by an external vendor or an external commercial player, open allows those who are using it, and libraries in this case, to determine the direction they want to go, the features that they would like to introduce, the functions that they must serve, and the values that they represent. Closed is also powerful. With it comes control. With it comes incredible value-making opportunities. And in the information age, we've seen a different calculus about the ability and the need for systems to systems and economies to organize themselves with centripetal forces, with things growing larger and larger, and the cost of distribution basically dropping to pretty much nothing. With the very recent acquisition by Clarivate of ProQuest, which had itself just acquired XLibris rather recently, we're seeing the continued consolidation of the information services and the library market, something that's been on trend and on point for at least for the last 3 or 4 decades. We are seeing vertically integrated companies that are emerging that control everything from the content to the technology and platforms and the price of information and systems that are available. While open is a powerful and compelling vision, at least to me and my colleagues in the Open Library Foundation, it's perhaps not so far-fetched to imagine a different extreme or a different outcome where we might go to the Apple Store in order to visit the Apple Library. We've already seen Amazon, which bills itself as the world's largest bookstore, develop and deliver content that is exclusively available on Amazon, even to the point of having one-click access to the Kindle, their own hardware device. Are we too far away from a future where you'd have to go to the Elsevier store to get your Samsung reader maintained? It's not so far off, I think. Our vision at the Open Library Foundation is ultimately that libraries will be well served and can produce a thriving marketplace of open source library solutions. Solutions that are interoperable and complementary, both with both open and commercial systems. And we believe that there is a global network of open source projects and institutions. The time for focusing on national or even regional collaborations is, I think, that there will always be a role, but we are working at a scale where open source software in particular is something that can run in any of the continents and be available to any of the information providers or the patrons or the citizens of any country on earth. Finally, we believe that and have a vision that a thriving marketplace of open source library solutions that are developed, delivered, and maintained by healthy communities that bring libraries, developers, and commercial service providers all together sharing common interests and working together in concert. The Open Library Foundation was originally founded in 2016 when the early activists and developers of the Folio Project realized that it needed an independent home and a place that could hold the intellectual property and help steward the community for both the Folio Project, but also other communities in other parts of the world. The Open Library Foundation now spans 5 full projects and 2 incubator projects, or one talks with 2 additional projects. And it itself is no longer an infant, but is also in its adolescence, I would say. Beth named off the Advanced Research Consortium, the GoKB, ReShare, and ViewFind, which have joined Folio as full projects. Over the course of this week or the next few days, you will also hear about new projects such as LDP, or the library data platform, which is dedicated to an open source and robust mechanism and platform for doing data reporting and visualization for data that libraries care about from any source. The Open Library Foundation is all volunteer. Everyone who put on this conference and that goes BC speaking is volunteering their own time, is coming from many different institutions to work together. And we're active across three different continents in Asia, Europe, and North America at this point. Reducing what we see and the services that we believe we provide where there's a need, we can do it. We can distill our mission down to three key terms: foster, connect, and support. We believe we exist to foster open source software as a viable, reputable, and vibrant alternative to commercial mechanisms and commercial systems themselves. We believe in connecting the entire ecosystem, open source projects with each other, open source developers with libraries and the commercial providers that they might work with. We believe in connecting marketplaces with each other. And ultimately, we believe in connecting individual patrons with the libraries that serve them. Finally, for the open source projects that need them, we provide direct support. That might be in terms of legal and financial services for projects that need them, or it might be for general communications and outreach, not only for projects that are within the Open Library Foundation, but similar projects and complementary projects wherever they may be in the world. Ultimately, the most important service and the most important function that we believe we provide is to serve as a community of communities, allowing different stakeholders and different players to come together, work with each other, and enrich the entire library ecosystem. Over the next couple of years, we will be investing heavily in advocacy for open source software in libraries. We will be looking at incubating an increasing number of projects and providing support, especially for up and coming projects, to help contribute to and enrich this marketplace and this ecosystem. And we'll be doing both of these things at an international scale. We believe that we want to invest heavily in not only Europe, Asia, and North America, but the other continents as well, serving both the global North and the global South. This is a good opportunity, and we have a little bit of time, but I would like to draw people to the Open Library Foundation's website at openlibraryfoundation.org. If you've not already signed up and been receiving our newsletters, we have sent out an inaugural newsletter curated by Beth. Thank you very much, as well as a team of content developers, editors, and marketing wizards. We also, you can follow the Open Library Foundation on Twitter at Open Library FDN. Finally, the Open Library Foundation is governed by a board of director, which has 7 seats. We currently have 2 seats that will be opening up, and we've made an open call for people to self-nominate and express interest in joining the board to help us achieve our common mission. You can find the expression of interest form on the Foundation's website at openlibraryfoundation.org, and those will be open for the next 9 days. We encourage anyone who is interested to apply. We also encourage, if you know someone, to do some outreach and do some connecting yourself. We've now reached the point where we would have time for Kaitlin Theaney, the Executive Director for Invest in Open Infrastructure, to provide a keynote. And I believe Kaitlin is still not on. I haven't seen sign that she has joined. And I see none of my co-panelists or co-hosts are jumping in. So there is one question. I'm going to go back. Why don't we take one question or any discussion? And then after that, I think one thing that a year of Zoom has taught me is that people do not mind a break, especially if it's in the middle or at the end of the day. And we can take a break before the next conference session is scheduled to start, which I believe is, I'm not going to do the time zone calculation. Beth may be able to do that. One of the questions, or the one question that I see open, is what are the requirements of projects that are seeking incubation support by the Open Library Foundation? Thank you. That's an excellent question. And I would actually reverse that and say, what are the needs of the projects and how can the foundation be of assistance? So the foundation exists to support and incubate projects. Many projects are already mature, have well-defined communities, and have even established themselves with administrative agents or fiscal hosts to provide financial or intellectual property services. We also know that many projects are actually just starting out, would like to get to that point, and they may have challenges in terms of identifying a governance structure, attracting resources, establishing sustainability models, or just doing communications and outreach so other people are aware of their existence. If you are in a project that is in one of these states, you would be most welcome to reach out to info@openlibraryfoundation.org, and we can begin a discussion. So at this point, there aren't hard and fast requirements, except for the fact that I think that open source software needs to be essential. If you're working on something else, that's probably not for this foundation. Let's see, another question. Beth, can I throw this one to you? Oh, and I see Kaitlin has joined us, which is fantastic. Why don't we take one more question, and Kaitlin, while you're getting yourself set up, and then we'll turn it over to our keynote. There's a little bit of adrenaline today for this Tuesday morning in the US. Beth, how can individuals get involved?
Sure, that's a great question. So we have several committees that we are, we have a membership committee, the WOLFCon committee, and we're looking on expanding into more continuing education and that type of programming. And so the best way to get involved is to reach out again to that info at I won't repeat it because I won't get it right, email address or the contact us form, and then we can get you connected with whatever skill sets and whatever way that you feel called to serve. We also, like one of the things that we have is we have this body of communities. And so if there is a type of volunteer opportunity that you're looking for, that maybe OLF isn't the right fit, but we have these five different groups that also are always continually looking for volunteers. And so we hope to be able to also not just have volunteers with OLF, but also be able to connect to the communities that are part of the foundation. So just shoot us an email and we'll happy to talk and get more involved.
We will be seeing, this WOLFCon is just getting started, but of course all the planning, knock on wood, has been complete. We will be seeing WOLFCon run again next year, and we would love to have additional volunteers. It will be in September in Germany. We have a fantastic team. That was actually all geared up to host and deliver WOLFCon last year before the pandemic struck. We'll also be looking at doing things like training and informational sessions, as well as advocacy and open source. And if you're interested in any type of that work along those lines, knowledge dissemination, training, even policy work, we'd be very keen to hear from you. There's a related question here, which is, what if it's not software, but another effort such as the Open Cataloging Rules Project? That definitely fits with the Open Library Foundation. And in fact, in the charter for the organization, we talk not just about open source software, but also open access, open data, and open knowledge. So I think Open Cataloging Rules, which, as I understand it, is interested in really creating a knowledge base and advancing the cataloging practice, would go hand in glove and be a perfect complement to the ecosystem and part of the thriving marketplace that we envision. All right, Kaitlin, how are you?
I am here. Sorry about that. We had a little bit of a family emergency this morning. Can you hear me okay?
We can hear you just fine. It's great to see you.
I'm so sorry about that, Tom.
Oh, no, it's exciting. Even it's like a real conference where these things happen. Let me give you a little bit of introduction, and then I'll drop the share and you can jump right in.
Sounds great.
All right. So we are thrilled to be joined by Kaitlin, not only because she successfully navigated a family emergency, but because she is the executive director of a relatively new initiative called Invest in Open Infrastructure, which is itself a nonprofit initiative dedicated to improving funding and resourcing for open technologies and systems that research relies on. She has previously served as the endowment director for the Wikimedia Foundation, where she led the development of a fund to sustain the future of Wikipedia and free knowledge. Prior to joining Wikimedia, Kaitlin was the director of the program portfolio for the Mozilla Foundation, which followed her time building the Mozilla Science Lab, a program to serve the open research community. She was on the founding team for digital science, where she helped launch and advise programs to serve researchers worldwide, and built on her time at the Creative Commons, where she crafted legal, technical, and social infrastructure for sharing data on the web. Kaitlin, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, Tom, and thank you to the organizers. Also, thank you for your patience. You know, a kid falls at a playground, running out, coming back is not always the way I want to start my mornings, but we're here. But also, I'm super excited to be joining you all to kick off this year's WOLFcon. Sort of funnily enough, our child's first name is a version of wolf, but from the Hebrew, his name is Zev. So it's very near and dear to start it with Zev needing some care this morning. So I'm just going to take a moment here and share my screen. I'll see if we can get this all up and going. Let's see. Dun, dun. Here we go. Is that all coming through for you all?
Looks good.
Perfect. Okay, great. So the you know, in terms of thinking on some of the themes for WOLFcon, also with the sort of rich history, not only for the Open Library Foundation, but also for the work that Tom kind of gave you a bit of a glimpse at over the course of my career, accessibility and sustainability for open source and open access has, you know, I can pull that almost straight from the WOLFcon and the Open Library Foundation page and probably just apply that to the last 15 years of work. The work that we're doing now for Invest in Open Infrastructure, I'll share a little bit about what we're doing today. But the aim of this talk is really to talk about this sort of need for open infrastructure, why this feels especially timely, knowing that many members here in the community have been working on this for quite some time. So hopefully something mix of provocative and also sharing some of the next steps of how we're approaching this work. To start, I've never thought that the word infrastructure would be used so frequently over the past 18 months, especially coming into a project such as Invest in Open Infrastructure last year. But it is having a bit of a moment. We are seeing such a very expansive and diverse conversation about infrastructure, even especially outside of higher ed, in terms of digital public infrastructure, roads and bridges sorts of infrastructure, bandwidth and broadband and things like that as well. As well as we've seen with the sort of pressing needs of all of the various crises that hit last year and have been, you know, kind of brewing under the surface for quite some time, the increased demand for access to research, access to educational materials, the dissemination of these sorts of materials and what that has done to our underlying systems. Philanthropies have pivoted their entire funding portfolios. I will make these slides available as well. You can go through these links. Including, you know, the Siegel Family Endowment, who announced last summer with a white paper on the physical, social, and technical infrastructure that they would be investing $23 million this calendar year alone in infrastructure investments. National governments, as you've seen, not only in the U.S., but also more broadly, are raising infrastructure as a banner, not only for investment into the systems that we rely on from physical, social, and technical, but also raising that as a banner for equity and change. And I know here in the States, the Biden infrastructure agenda, we're looking at trillions of dollars to be invested in that. And also infrastructure institutes are popping up, funding programs, even industry plays. I gave a talk earlier in the pandemic in the fall, and was immediately followed with the announcement of the launch of the Open Infrastructure Foundation, which OpenStax and the open source community had moved forward. And so it seems like there is a real inflection point when we talk about the work that this community has been so embedded in and the work that we are here at IOI to support. But one of my main questions is, are we all actually talking about the same thing? When we talk about digital infrastructure, does that align with our conceptions of open and what we think of in terms of criteria for what makes an open system? When we say public, is that public within a certain enclosure, or is that public for all? How expansive is that? Is that within our traditions, within our communities, or is that really looking at it in a global setting? When we talk about infrastructure, are we including software and tools? There are various schools of thought about this. What about the social dimension? And we have a webinar tomorrow, which I'll talk a little bit more about, actually digging into some of those elements about labor and maintenance, especially when you talk about open source communities, about the individuals and the in-kind contributorship, and also the, you know, need for actual human beings to help engage in that work. And also, who gets to decide what definition gets applied? And so when we talk about infrastructure, and for the sake of this talk, I would say that this is going to be an evolving definition. I'm a firm believer in that sort of iterative and reflective and responsive way of approaching some of these complex systems and also complex problems. And so I would say, you know, we will continue to go back and revisit this definition. But for the sake of this discussion here, I think how we look at it, if we had to distill it to the highest level, thinking of infrastructure as the systems, protocols, software that research and scholarship, which is our specific focus for our work on infrastructure, that they rely on. There's that dependency in terms of, would you notice if the, you know, piece of the system is removed? Would that disrupt the workflow process, and to what extent? And, you know, we're continuing again to build out a framework for how we can best understand and make decisions about what counts as infrastructure, what counts as, you know, other systems that may plug into that. But for the sake of today, that's where we're sort of going to start from. But then when we talk about open infrastructure or open source infrastructure, it gets into a little bit of word soup. To me, there's, and also to some of the members of our steering committee and others that have been involved with Invest in Open Infrastructure, even predating my involvement, we talk about some additional elements that I think we really benefit from being made more explicit. These sort of presumptions about when we say open source, it's not just something that's, you know, publicly available in a GitHub repository, but openness ingrained at the operational and design level. Solutions should be open source, yes, the content and data openly licensed, transparent pricing, clear governance, guidance on how decisions are made. How are all of those manifesting within a project? Second, looking at open infrastructure as an enabler for communities to deliver collective benefits. They should be maximally, infrastructure should be maximally accessible for equitable participation, adoption, and usage without restrictions, governed by community needs, responsive to community needs. And then third, the infrastructure that we're looking at, we really believe that it should be facilitating the creation and the dissemination of open knowledge, and really helping to, you know, make this production and sharing of knowledge something that is available with minimal restriction to participate and also to access. Thankfully, there have been a number of colleagues in the space that have done significant amounts of work to further unpack some of these other sorts of criteria that start to kind of color our understanding of open infrastructure. This is one of those examples from CORE as well as Spark, building on the principles for open scholarly infrastructure that colleagues at CrossRef and Curtin University have built out. And looking at, you know, some of the other elements in terms of governance, in terms of fair data collection, in terms of easy migration, succession planning, what happens if a project, you know, needs to shut down or sunset, as well as the transparent pricing and contracts so that we can help build a sort of a healthier ecosystem. We did some work, which I'll talk a little bit more in a bit, where we also looked across a number of these various values and principles based sort of documents. There's some from the Educopia Institute, some through the Next Generation Library Publishing Project through that work from Educopia, others that are being applied in terms of national funding frameworks. And so we've, you know, started to see a really interesting sort of building out of how these sorts of decisions are being made about the core infrastructure within research and scholarship, and also how we're applying collectively values to understanding the space and helping to advance the ecosystem. My aim is, and my hope is, that we can hopefully start to mesh those together a little bit too. But really, it's all premised on this notion that, you know, the ecosystem we're operating in is sick. This was mentioned to me by a colleague when we were talking about, you know, the usual frame of thinking about the problems or the friction points within communities, and really thinking that, you know, the current ecosystem, if you think about it, we talk about it as an ecosystem for scholarly research and knowledge production. It's geared towards commoditization, it's cost prohibitive, it's skewed towards profit generation, not just in terms of commercial players and monopolies, but also within higher ed and institutions, treating knowledge as a commodity. And it privileges the well-resourced. It devalues and underserves the scholarly research community in many ways, and perpetuates a system that rewards prestige and exclusion and walled gardens. And I think when we start to talk about the ecosystem being sick, we then start to understand where, you know, other elements such as our infrastructure and our technical choices and our systems that, you know, help fuel participation in that, why those are also, you know, having their own sort of issues and sick as a result of that. So digging into this a little bit more, I joined Invest in Open Infrastructure last March. Many of you remember last March. It was a fascinating time in, you know, not only a global health crisis, racial and social justice crisis, economic collapse. I like to reflect on this quote from Naomi Klein, who authored The Shock Doctrine and is known for the phrase disaster capitalism, about, you know, this crisis, like earlier ones, could well be the catalyst to shower aid on the wealthiest interests in society, including those most responsible for our current vulnerabilities. This was something that we perceived as, you know, an ongoing issue in the space, but was exacerbated by some of these, not only increase of demand, but also the financial volatility that we saw last year. And so digging into some of this and looking at some of the problems in the ecosystem, even just a few weeks ago, seeing not only another acquisition at a global scale, but Clarivate buying ProQuest for $5.3 billion. You know, this is where I start to think of it as a perceived scarcity of funds. There is definitely money in the system, but as Roger Schoenfield from Ithaca SNR was saying and tweeting out some of the moments and some of the comments from the conference call that was happening, you know, talking about this as enterprise software's fastest growing market, you know, significant cross-selling opportunities, a Bloomberg for academia, an end-to-end research intelligence platform. You know, some of the things here that, you know, when we talk about why open source and open infrastructure is needed to provide alternatives to the increased consolidation and commodification of this ecosystem, you know, recognizing that, you know, between ProQuest and Clarivate, you not only have a kindergarten to postgraduate level data collection pipeline, you also have significant product, you know, concentrations and integrations that make it really difficult to, you know, disrupt that at an institutional level. And so what you get is lock-in. What you get is a limitation of choice. What you get is also surveillance in terms of the way in which the data is perpetually, you know, not only collected, but then used as our core metric systems for measuring things such as promotion and tenure and contributing to that as well. This here is an example, just looking at the acquisitions and the products that are under the Elsevier umbrella. And I apologize for it being slightly fuzzy, but you can see here that you not only have the research tool investment side of things, but then also interplay in terms of publishing, and then also research evaluation. So the same individuals that are looking to sell tools and also to, you know, profit off of the research that scholars are kind of putting into the system and wanting to share more broadly, that they are also the ones deciding about how that gets rated and ranked. And so, you know, looking at some of the concerns here, when you see that sort of increased consolidation of power amongst a core and few set of individuals and corporations. There also are privacy issues that came to light in a big way in the over the course of the last year. The top quote here from Bill Fitzgerald, who is Consumer Reports' privacy expert, about privacy getting shortchanged in the education space for years before COVID, and that now everyone has firsthand experience with software at a level that they never have had before. And that issues that have been ignored are getting attention quickly. We've seen this with proctoring software. We've seen this with course management software. We've seen this also with some of the tools and software that have been more heavily embedded in the scholarly communication ecosystem, and also the research tools that the data then leads to building out a bigger picture of user behavior that then gets targeted. Shay Swager, who's a librarian in Colorado, also this great piece in Technology Review recently about software that monitors students during tests, perpetuates inequality, and violates privacy. And so some really big questions about what does oversight look like? What sort of decisions do we need to build and, you know, have in terms of governance for the systems that we're building? And also, to me, when we talk about open infrastructure, having that be responsive to the needs of the community and having an opportunity to have that transparency so that these sorts of issues can be surfaced, and making sure that those who are most affected by the tools that are being created are part of the conversation. There's also, you know, broader considerations when we talk about the data capitalism or surveillance capitalism of many of these tools. You know, librarianship at the crossroads of ICE surveillance was a piece that Sarah Lambden, who's a professor of law at CUNY here in New York City, where I live, you know, talking about these big publishers, big commercial publishers, less as publishers and more as data barons, sweeping up broad swaths of data to repackage and sell. This sort of big data economy is something that we have known has been brewing. There are many examples outside of higher ed and research that, you know, we've seen with the Googles and the Amazons and the Microsofts of the world. And, you know, recognizing that the systems that are being sold within institutions that we are working to provide open alternatives for, that are values aligned and transparent, are also facing and butting up against similar issues. And so how are we intentionally forcing that conversation to make sure that we are building things that are putting equity and safety at the core of the work? And recently as well, I mean, it just keeps coming in terms of Microsoft Academic, which many projects relied on, especially in the bibliometric space, you know, talking about expanding into new horizons and taking community approaches for academic research. And then not having any details about what that looked like, what that handoff looked like, and talking about shutting down the service. You know, the things that we've heard from those who were paying customers of Microsoft Academic is that they found out about the discontinuation of the service from Twitter, not from any sort of outreach that had been done to, you know, those that were customers of the service, and recognizing that something that may have been, you know, an altruistic public benefit sort of development from a company, this is why we need, you know, investments in the governance of these projects and stewardship so that we can ensure that there are plans and also engagement with others that are being affected by these tools. So I would say that, you know, we need open infrastructure as an equalizer as well as an enabler. When we talk about the building of our tools, you know, to me, infrastructure is not neutral. Our technical choices are not neutral. Participation in open knowledge is not a passive or apolitical act. It's intentional, and it's there to help advance our understanding of society. And I think that recognizing it as such is powerful and necessary. We also need to re-examine our baseline assumptions. You know, thinking 10 years ago about, you know, the sort of in the do no evil sort of times of Google, of these big tech platforms and others like the Microsoft example, providing services that would allow for new opportunities and engagement, you know, really questioning our assumptions that those platforms are operating in our best interest and are inherently good, instead of, you know, looking at them with certain levels of scrutiny to ensure that they are really designed to increase freedoms and opportunities, or that we also are putting in the mechanisms and building the mechanisms that can ensure and protect that. So how to move forward with all of this complex space and complex definitional space? We have been exploring various ways through Invest in Open Infrastructure, not only to examine means of providing additional insight into the sustainability of, you know, the broader sector by providing guidance to institutional colleagues and also institutional leaders, funders, or those who could help fund and support this ecosystem, but also looking at means in which of moving forward collective action, knowing the complex system this all interacts in. So when we talk about sort of things that we can do in the near term, how can we work within existing technology investments, existing systems, focusing on interoperability as a form of resilience, looking at where we can build modularity into the tools that we have, looking at where we can help build additional forms of resilience by having protocols that might allow for easy migration should that be needed, or transfer of knowledge and more frictionless boundaries between. On the medium term, where can we leverage existing models and frameworks that might be supporting areas of scholarship, but could be helping to, diversify the body of support for core infrastructure projects in terms of staffing, in terms of investment on the software development side, maintaining, also in financial investment, hosting, et cetera. In longer term, what does it look like to transform our support models and our assumptions to have a broader sort of ecosystem that is at its core built for the needs of the academy, built for the needs of researchers, and putting openness and equitable participation at the center of it? For IOI, we came about out of an event back in 2018, long before I joined Invest in Open Infrastructure. It was called the Joint Roadmap of Open Science Tools Conference, and came out of conversations with others engaged in the space, from infrastructure providers, advocacy organizations, librarians, institutional decision makers, funders, to say, listen, we need to think of ways to address the sustainability challenges of building open tools to serve research and scholarship. From that time, that coalition helped build out a sort of frame for Invest in Open Infrastructure to exist in. And when I joined, really starting to think about what can our unique value be to helping to advance some of these core issues. And so our approach, to date is to conduct research, help build out the evidence base, so that when we say, we don't have as much support for the ecosystem, we can say, and here are the strategies, and here's what we're calling for, and here's where that can be best affected and best directed in a means that has an understanding of, how that can play out. So how can we increase our understanding of the current landscape across all of the various dimensions we operate in, so that we can do that most effectively? And how can we craft resources to help those who are not only assessing open infrastructure for adoption and investment, building open infrastructure, and those who are looking to invest in open infrastructure to help, whether it's subsidize, further support, maximize their investment in these systems so that we can help move towards a healthier ecosystem. We also pilot solutions. We put that research into action. We've done this in a number of ways, but really looking at means of which we can convene key individuals and stakeholders and organizations, work alongside those who are also advancing this work in their regions of the world and in their specific disciplines and institutions, to further a shared agenda for investing in open infrastructure. This coordination piece, I think, is really important, because we are one organization. We exist alongside many others who have been working to advance, including, members of the Open Library Foundation community, to move this work forward. And so where can we expand, amplify, further, align with these broader initiatives so that we can be more impactful and help maximize that change? Over the past year, we've been working with individuals like Tom and many people on this call to better understand and to dig into areas around infrastructure investment to help further open scholarship This Future of Open Scholarship project, we've an open comment period for our report, which we'll be sharing soon. But the work had over 95 interviews, almost 130 participants from 18 countries and 5 continents around the world, made up of infrastructure providers, many that are working within libraries, and also institutional roles, scholarly societies, university presses, those that were working on other forms of open publication, and advocacy groups as well. You will see here from this high level visualization, there's concentration of individuals within the US. This was stood up as a sort of responsive, how can we help level sort of research. And so individual participation was on a self-selected basis. Though we did have representation throughout Europe, Africa, MENA, Australia, and New Zealand. We did have less participation in Latin America, though we've been working on ways in which we can help better explore that as well. And some of the things that came up in that work over the past year, especially when it comes to some of the technical components, knowing that that is in many cases at the core of the work of the Open Library Foundation and this broader community that we've convened here today, are some of these tension points, especially over the course of the last 18 months, when we talk about time and the relationship in time and how that manifests in our decisions about open source development, open source maintenance in our systems. What sort of time is available to be invested in the development and maintenance and nurturing? And what sort of runway is there for some of these projects versus what's available? And we saw that balance of immediacy really come to bear over the past year. The prioritization of, when you have resources at your institution, but you might be looking to invest them in the development of a shared piece of infrastructure that, how do you prioritize whether or not you look at near-term gain versus long-term investment? Also, what sort of development priorities get those resources first? In many cases, we heard individuals refer to this as local first development of solving the institution's needs, even knowing if that was that sort of customization or that sort of build was maybe operating or slowing down the advancement of the shared infrastructure on the whole, but needing to serve those immediate needs of an institution or a certain community there as well. The staffing and labor elements there of, how do you develop, maintain, and sustain, as well as understand the staffing and labor costs and needs. We heard from many of our participants that it was virtually impossible for them to be able to tell how much engagement, how much staffing was needed for certain projects based on, whether it was in budgets put into overhead and not necessarily broken down so that you could see, or volunteered in kind in addition to other roles. And when we saw the sweeping, furloughs and also constraints on hiring over the past year, as well as layoffs, recognizing that the implication for open source projects where so much, whether it's governance, maintenance, staffing in terms of software development, or even helping to embed sort of training and adoption within an institution, that with the already sort of taxed workforce, we saw that come under even more scrutiny in terms of the bringing forward some of the additional fragility of the ways in which we look at supporting these systems. Also looking at some of the resourcing trade-offs, are the systems that we're building favoring usual suspects or bigger players? Who's contributing? Who's not? What is being subsidized? How's that being communicated? And again, this perceived resource scarcity and the effects of that. IOI came about from discussions of there not being enough funding for the ecosystem, or there not being enough long-term funding for the ecosystem, and only having a handful of philanthropic funders who are supporting and some government agencies. I think that there are ways in which we should be calling on other stakeholders in the broader community, whether it's consortia, industry players, other research councils, funding agencies, et cetera, to call on a level of investment to help ensure that we can have a vibrant and healthy ecosystem that puts at the core of it collaboration rather than forcing competition amongst various open solutions based on limitations on funding or restrictions in terms of portfolio. And also recognizing that in many cases for the technology systems we're looking at, this is from Access WW, the legacy technologies are 20 to 25 years old. And so, you know, knowing that we have a lot of technical debt and other elements that, you know, teams are across the board, whether it's in a distributed fashion or kind of concentrated within certain vendors that are looking to support ecosystems or individuals within institutions are working to help address. But, you know, we are in many cases not just working with new tools that have been developed to solve problems, but we also are dealing with some legacy technology issues as well. And so when we talk about equitable access, you know, equitable for whom? We talk about shared infrastructure. This question comes up about, well, are you focusing on North America? Are you focusing on the well-resourced? Are you focusing on Western institutions and scholars? Are you focusing on everybody? And I think that that's a key question and important frame for our work moving forward, and something I would encourage you all to think through as you go through this, the next few sort of sessions and over the course of this conference. We like to think of our work as operating at sort of a layer cake of systemic inequities when we talk about the multi-level barriers that exist. When we, you know, looking at the inequities that exist within open source, the inequities that exist within higher education, and especially in our world where we're talking about providing investment guidance, where we're talking about longer term sustainability. If we don't approach this work thoughtfully, there is a real risk that we will be codifying and further locking in systems that are operating against our best interest as a global research community. And so ensuring that we are embedding and engaging and having involved in our governance the voices that are often missing from these conversations, and continually moving through ways in which we can invite and engage with those voices so that we can move beyond our usual suspect circles. So what we're building towards for our work, thinking about collective power and collective action in a number of ways through trusted peer networks, calling for increased accountability, also negotiating power, thinking of ways we can empower institutional leaders to take a more active role as a collective in calling for the change that they want to see, whether it's engaging with vendors, engaging with other you know, tools that might exist, service providers, how can we align power, influence, and also budgets towards these shared needs to direct funding effectively in measurable ways that combat some of these problems that, you know, help ensure that we've got viable, durable, reliable, open alternatives that have, you know, the resources there to help support the ecosystem and support the communities of researchers and scholars that we're looking to help engage. And also at the core of this, increasing the amount of funding and diversity of those in funding this infrastructure to move beyond the, you know, three or four philanthropic organizations and a handful of government agencies to say, what does it look like if we ask others to contribute, those who are deriving value off of open knowledge production from institutions and higher education? What would it look like if we were building a healthy and resilient and sustainable future for research and scholarship collectively? How could that start to manifest, and what are the models to help move that forward? Often comes up about, you know, well, we know what's not enough. And so thinking through what is an approach to figure out and how we move forward with the complexity of figuring how to best identify what is needed to fix the system. Some of the elements that are going to be really important in our work over the next year is identifying and you know, kind of building out a framework for how do we prioritize open infrastructure needs for maximal benefit, and who does that serve? How are we scoping those questions? There's a number of different ways we can approach that problem, and that is work that we're excited to be able to not only dig into, but also share for broader consultation with communities we serve, including this one here. And so our next steps, unpacking what we don't know. We're in the process of bringing on and building our analyst team so that we can start to do research not only into the hidden costs of open infrastructure around staffing, around labor, around maintenance, but also looking at what gaps there might be in supporting these projects and the sustainability. Where are there examples we can learn from, examples we can build towards. And so we've got a webinar tomorrow, June 2nd, which I think may directly conflict with this conference. It will be recorded, but also looking at, you know, can we start to examine funding data? And we've started some preliminary investigation of this to see, you know, where are there trends, where are there gaps or concentrations that we should be learning from that can help us better understand where flows of capital are going. You know, looking at the infrastructure landscape, what projects should we be prioritizing? How are we going about that work? So some really, really deep questions. We're also in the process of establishing an open infrastructure tech oversight function from that Clarivate and ProQuest announcement. It really kind of brought home the need for a community conversation and also a means to galvanize action and a bigger conversation about the impact of higher education's technical choices and investments. Defining our scope, as well as evolving our governance model. This is work that we are actively engaged in now, but understanding, you know, that the decision-making component is sort of inextricably linked from how we move forward with this work, what sort of trust moves forward with this work, and how we can best serve our communities. And so making sure that to reflect the change that we need, we have representation and community input that is kind of consistently and continuously built into our processes. I'll end with saying that, you know, for open research and access to knowledge, it requires open infrastructure. These things are inextricably linked. You can also sub in open access. For open access, it requires open infrastructure. But at the core of that, you know, equitable and accessible participation in knowledge production, it requires our infrastructure similarly aligned. These things can't operate sort of in separate planes anymore and need to be anchored in community values and governance. That means shifting our reliance from players that are misaligned with core values of the community, transparency, and also collective responsibility. And I invite you all to join us, and I look forward to continuing this conversation in the Q&A section.
Great. Thank you so much for that presentation. I think it's really applicable to our work here. And so the Q&As are now open. So feel free to type in your questions. I might get us started with a question here is, what brought you to focus on open and scholarly infrastructure? Was there an aha moment for you or like a call to action that brought you to this work?
I started in this work in 2005. I actually was a former, you know, crime reporter at the Boston Globe, and then got into freedom of the press work and First Amendment cyber law work. The reason I kind of, and this was in the early Creative Commons days where we were building out the science team, so early open access and then open data work. What brought me to that work and what brought a number of my colleagues to that work was some really personal stories. There were friends and family members that were afflicted with rare degenerative diseases that weren't able to access the information they needed to get the medical help that they wanted. So there were real, you know, people I could call and say, you know, I'm working to help move this forward, and I told you I would help. Our initial, a lot of people don't know this, but for that work, which used to be called Science Commons, but we'll just call it the science work from Creative Commons in the early days, we were based in Boston. These individuals for these rare and neglected disease research foundations were in very literally in many cases in our backyard, and were flying under the sort of cover of federal funding. And so they had more flexibility, but also more urgency to try out collaborative models. And so in the early days, much of the work that we were doing for testing out shared models for content, for data, for biological materials, cyber infrastructure at the time, as we were talking about it, were with individuals such as, you know, the Parkinson's researchers, cystic fibrosis, Cordoma Foundation, Alzheimer's and ALS and things like that. And so that was our very sort of personal calling. It was there to help, you know, ensure that a friend was able to stay out of a wheelchair for a little bit longer. And then that moved into a broader career of helping to further advance this work.
Thank you. So here's a question. Can you say more about how an HEI is to decide in the near term which open communities to support, especially given the local first development attitude and resource scarcity reality you mentioned?
It's a big question. It is a big question. I wish I had like an immediate answer for how to do that. It's something that, so the work that we were doing over the past year also involved, as I mentioned kind of casually in the beginning, investigating and initially working to create sort of a core sort of decision-making framework across these 130 participants. As you can imagine, that turned out to be a lot more challenging than you would anticipate in terms of, you know, whose values get applied, in terms of also what aims in advancing some of this work get applied. So, you know, when it comes to scoping, that I think is one of the big questions. Some of the things that we're looking at now are ways in which we can help synthesize the needs that we're hearing, or even look at it in terms of, you know, what would help foster equitable participation? Like what is the foundational set of infrastructures that are needed from compute space, open tools for analysis, content data repositories, discovery and archival areas and things like that to help bring a lens to this. But this is something that's going to be a top item for our next year of work, is identifying what that framework looks like, how to help provide that guidance, and what is sort of in and without, like within our capacity, because it could be an ever growing issue. If it means, you know, kind of tailoring it towards individual needs for every institution. So I think what I would love to hear, and this is an open invitation, you know, my contact information is available, in terms of, you know, what ways in which, without kind of watering down the broader impact and value, are there core needs that we can help gear our efforts towards as we build out our team, build out our capacity? Are there, you know, additional lenses that would be useful that are unexplored, or, you know, individuals are finding particular struggles with in terms of sifting through doing that vetting and decision making? And also part of why we've put the tech oversight group as something that we're looking to build out is to create a peer network where individuals can share how they are approaching these decisions beyond the decision-making frameworks and trying to apply those individually. Because what we heard from our work was that this is something that, you know, one institution would have loved to know that this institution was grappling with the same issues, but not having a vehicle for that. So we're going to be testing out some models for how we can help support that as well through those means.
Thank you. Another question here. They're just rolling in through the Q&A, so it's great. It seems that for some open projects initiatives that have failed, it isn't the tech that doesn't work, but the governance. What are you seeing emerge as governance models that reinforce commitment to the collective?
Oh, it's a really important question. I think, and I've seen this from a couple different, Tom and I used to be on a board together in terms of others that were kind of operating in this broader space. And we've seen governance groups that have been on the small side, those that have had different structures with, you know, broader transparency, requests for comments, working groups, others that have bigger sort of member base. One of the interesting elements there is, I think, understanding what the governance is in service of, and what that sort of makeup and representation helps enable. So for example, you know, when you're looking at membership-based governance, ensuring, you know, if you have a product that needs to be relied upon by, say, 50, 100 institutions, that you also are augmenting that with those that can provide the expertise or can help with understanding that. Same thing goes for the business modeling, the fundraising components, et cetera. And so, you know, I think making sure that those elements are in balance is something that I'm perpetually sort of looking for, of where are there places to help, you know, bring that, to bring those elements to bear. Because we hear time and time again of governance groups that are, you know, the decision-making might feel too slow for the development of a tool, or it might feel divorced from the technical needs, or there might be resourcing challenges and trying to figure out what does the appropriate balance look like in those sorts of ways. There also are some really interesting models. I know on our end, we're looking at, we're fiscally sponsored. So, you know, our governance is something that we are building towards sort of in advance of needing to have sort of a formal board type thing. We've got a big steering committee. We're really thinking through some of these issues at the core of, you know, if we are looking at bringing systemic change to the ecosystem, you know, are we engaging with those who might be slightly adjacent to the sector that we exist in, but can apply those strategies to our space to put them in decision-making roles or to cultivate those connections to understand, you know, how collective action and say multinational cooperatives work that's in service of core communities. Where are other people doing that work that we can learn from, as well as ensuring that we are engaging in even maybe non-decision-making sort of capacities, communities to be responsive to the needs as those evolve. So we're not divorced from the realities of the infrastructure providers, of the institutional colleagues, of the funders that we're working with, but working alongside them as well. And so it's, you know, it's been a complicated thing to kind of unpack, but I would encourage organizations to think through, you know, what are the core bits of expertise that you need? How are you actively seeking or cultivating that and kind of working to bring in a governance model that allows for those discussions to help advance the core aims of your work?
You mentioned the Biden administration could potentially invest trillions in open infra. Are there other examples of interest engagement from city, state, national government agencies? It seems like public plus open is a natural fit.
There are, you know, I wish I had collected a better list for this conversation. I know that we've got colleagues on our steering committee in Australia. There's a new chief scientist there that's looking at infrastructure as a core element of the work that they're moving forward. There's Coalition Publica, which is Erudite and Public Knowledge Project in Canada, which is funded by the Canadian Research Knowledge Network. And I believe SSHRC, I might be getting that wrong. I'll go back and check, but ways in which of bringing sort of that open infrastructure and funding that at a more national level. In France, Marin Dacos, who is the open science, he leads the open science fund for the ministry there, has been applying the versions of the principles for open scholarly infrastructure to a fund for open. We've similarly seen announcements for spinning that up in the Netherlands. The European Commission is examining these sorts of things. Research councils are starting to examine this level of investment. And so I think that we will see more of this. It's to me now a matter of how are we aligning these efforts. And even for the Biden administration, you know, we talk about open infrastructure for research. There's a lot there that I think we need to do to help build out the visibility and also the understanding, you know, not only of what we are asking for, which kind of brings back to that question from the beginning of what are we looking like, how are we prioritizing, how are we providing insight and insight for what, like for whose aims are we looking for to help provide, but then also how are we matching that with the financial asks of what the costs associated are. So we can say we need X level of investment for Y. And that's where the really difficult work starts to come to bear. And so that's where we're looking at bringing on some analysts. There are other colleagues in the space that are, you know, also looking at means of understanding that market, understanding the finances and the economics of that, so that we can hopefully bring together these various bits of work to move that forward and maybe even help get open infrastructure for research onto that, you know, onto that discussion board.
One of the things that, you know, I've been hearing a lot is thinking about the these connection pieces and about getting disparate communities communicating together for that idea shared. Have in your work, have you seen particular models of that cross communication or that cross collaboration that have been really successful?
Oh, let me think. Yes, but I'm also trying to think of like specifics, and I think the coffee is still kicking in at that level. Like it's you know, we've seen this sort of happen, and I, you know, there are examples of, let's say, you know, committees within consortia or groups that are continuously coming together to kind of think through various bits of problem solving. Much of this happens organically. There are mechanisms where we see, you know, certain councils within some of these broader groups or within certain affinity groups. And I'm sure that, you know, I might hand it over to Tom, because I'm sure that within the Open Library Foundation, you've got pockets of these conversations as well that are happening in terms of bringing some alignment and looking at that. We've also seen more advocacy for certain areas. I know within the Open Library Foundation, there's work around controlled digital lending and Project Reshare, thinking of groups like Library Futures, others that have kind of come out in the past year to say, okay, where can we help further galvanize these conversations and galvanize actions, augmenting other efforts, et cetera. And I know Project Reshare has done quite a bit of this as well. And so I could come back to you with more examples probably later today, but that's a great question.
Great, thank you. All right, here is, thank you for articulating the challenge we are currently facing with shrinking staff and funding in the library level. We're also facing more scrutiny on providing value to current students and decreasing costs of education, which makes it particularly hard to redirect staff time and funding to shift to open infrastructure and content, especially for small schools. We're partnering in our consortium and with other consortia to try to address this. What advice do you have for articulating this need to institutional level stakeholders to get resources and patience for the transition?
This is something we recently received at the beginning of this year, some funding from the Mellon Foundation to specifically investigate some of the staffing and maintenance issues, the things that are sort of the anti-patterns, for lack of a better phrase, of what is not budgeted for or what is not as clear from some of the budgets, so that we can get a sense. Because, you know, in terms of we're going to make an ask for what sort of staffing might be needed or what sort of funding might be needed to better support the development of a project, I'm going to put it out there. My thesis is that we don't know because it's not being accounted for. And so what are the ways in which we can start, you know, and much of this is not quantitative analysis, it's qualitative. Can we start to get some understanding of, you know, what would be needed so that we're not just sort of saying, okay, $40,000, that sounds great. Yes, of course, I would love to do all of this work for 40. It might be that the need is at $400,000. It might not be one software developer. It might need 5 software developers. You know, where can we start to understand and model off of a couple different projects? And so we are about to bring on some analysts to identify a couple of core case studies and projects to investigate of different size and makes and model, so we can start to, you know, understand how they are approaching some of these areas and where there's room to grow, where there's room for further development, what we can uncover in that process. I would say that, you know, one of those persistent challenges of the software development support often being based on soft money, as well as maintenance support often being based on soft money, is something that we are very keen on continuing to raise sort of the volume of that with when we talk to funders about what some of the persistent issues are that are leading to the, you know, further fragility of the ecosystem, that we need to ensure that these things are staffed. The last part as well, in terms of how we can best account for that, is understanding, like, are there ways in which we can find a means of consistently across, and this is where some of the collective action comes in, like, are there ways in which we can have a broader way of being transparent with the ways in which this work is accounted for in the budgets, or means of sharing that information that can make it easier to gain a sense across a distributed open infrastructure project, what some of those staffing needs are, what some of those staffing requirements are, to help, again, further build that in as a part of practice. I know there's a lot of conversation around, like, building towards sustainable practice, right? Building towards best practice and sharing, you know, everything from governance, but also sharing out, you know, contracts, pricing, approaches to interoperability, all of that sort of stuff. You know, can we start to do that also for the staffing and the labor involved, so that we can not chronically under-resource and understaff the work that's really important to moving scholarship forward?
I think we might try to squeeze in the one last question that we have here. That is, I think there's some relationship with the previous one. This person works for a U.S. government institution, and that they
they often feel like that the institutions prefer to lock down proprietary platforms of software infrastructure. And then how can Open Infra push to win this over in this area? I'll just say, like, at a state institution, I see this a lot in the way of procurement works. So like in terms of accessibility, we have to have this VPAT, which in these open communities might not necessarily exist, or like, how do you even define a VPAT when, which is a voluntary product accessibility template, what does that even mean and cover, which makes it a barrier to, you know, adopting open. So where do you think that Open Infra could push to in this area?
Well, I mean, the procurement question, I feel, is almost like setting an invisible set of rules that someone has to, like, just to exclude other bits of competition. I'm going to be bold and say it. I don't operate within an institution. We've heard many of these stories, right? We've heard many of these conversations off the record with individuals that had wanted to go with open solutions. Or, you know, the example that comes to mind is when the Netherlands had a request for proposals for an open platform and ended up going with Elsevier for that platform, based on the fact that other open infrastructures found that they could not compete, right? And so I think the being really open about, and not, you know, to be redundant, but to be transparent and to force a conversation about, like, what is causing other open projects to feel like they can't be seen at an equal level, you know, so that we can move beyond sort of just the resourcing or the competitiveness. Like, I don't feel like those are necessarily healthy ways to say, okay, well, until it's competitive with this solution that has X amount more resourcing, X amount more staff, all of these sorts of elements, that's going to really get us anywhere. But this is where I do think that some of the other things that we've seen to kind of shift the frame of the argument, to look at, are we best serving our communities? And are we serving, like, their safety? Are we protecting their privacy? You know, are there elements here that are just really misaligned with the values of, or at least the core values and missions of the institution that need to force a reexamination? We heard anecdotally over the past year that individuals that were talking in terms of some of the budget cuts with the heads of IT or those that were controlling those budgets, and there were conversations around, you know, small membership fees for open infrastructures being on the cutting block, versus ongoing investments in providing everyone at the institution with, say, a Microsoft seat license or a Google Suite seat. And person saying, you don't question that, whether or not people use it or not. Why are you questioning this? And so this is where I think that the convening of stakeholders and those peer networks are really important for surfacing ways we can advance case making. For the work that IOI specifically is looking to do, also looking at where we can back that up with evidence and pull the best from finance, pull the best from business, pull the best from other sectors to bring to bear to this space, to start looking at other ways that we can start to approach that dialogue, that it's not open versus closed because open is better, which we might know and we might believe. But for those who are not as embedded in this space, you know, how can we start to move past that? And my presumption is that open is going to be more radically accepted post-pandemic, but it is also a really important time for thinking through collective action for how we can move that work forward and not just let this moment pass and think through the ways in which we saw the system break over the past 18 months and brought into stark relief some of the key systemic issues that we need to address. And so an open invitation for you all to join us in kind of further digging into that as well.
Well, thank you so much for the presentation today and the talk. And thank you to everyone who is attending. And we are on a quick break and we'll meet back at 10 after the hour, whatever that hour might be for you. And so that will be with our introduction to BUFind. So thank you all so much. And again, big thank you. Applause all around, I'm sure, to Kaitlin. So great. Thank you all.
Thanks, everybody.
Thanks, Kaitlin.